Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Kim Tucker, and I have the announcements for this morning. Please remember to sign the red fellowship registers that are in your pews. We want to welcome our guest preacher this morning, Reverend Jim Nags. Jim is an ordained minister and also a commissioner in the Salvation Army. We are so glad that he and his wife, Carolyn, can be with us while Pastor Vicki finishes up her vacation. And she will return to the office this week on Tuesday. The deacon's offering for the month of July is Grace's Place Food Pantry at Grace Lutheran Church in Summers Point. Please be generous as we help those who have food insecurities and needs. There is chancel choir rehearsal this week, no bell choir. And Pastor Vicki again will be in the pulpit next week. She did send me a last-minute text just moments ago reminding me that the Best of the Press nominations open up this Wednesday. This isn't the voting. This is the nominations. We have to get the most nominations. Only the top five get on the ballot. And you can only nominate once. As you may or may not know, we've been silver the last 2 years, so maybe in the spirit of the Olympics, this is the year that we go for the gold, okay? So starting on Wednesday, you will be able to nominate just once. Remember that we have some different categories like Best Place of Worship, Best Nursery School. Vicki has won the gold for Best Wedding Officiant 2 years in a row. But speaking of those nominations, you may have noticed an insert in your bulletin for a Full Moon Theater. And if you go to Coffee Hour, you'll see that we started loading in our set. The show opens July 19th. Pre-sales have already been exciting and vast. So if you want to come, please get on the list. You can go to the website, fullmoontheater.org, or you can just call Carmela in the office and get on the list to see the show. But you can vote for us for the best community theater as well for Full Moon Theater. So now let us begin worship by listening to the introit.
Good morning. Please join me for the call to worship as is listed in your bulletin. Let God's praise be sung.
From her majesty to the fruited plains.
Let the echo of praise resound.
From sea to shining sea, in every nation, in every heart.
Let the word of God's grace fill the spacious skies. Let it come from the mouths of children and the lips of saints.
Let us worship God.
Please turn to page 696 in your hymnal as we sing America the Beautiful, all three verses, 1, 2, and 3.
Thank you.
Please be seated. And if you would join me in the prayer listed in the bulletin. Merciful God, you spread out your glory in every landscape and your love in all our lives. But we often miss the signs of your presence and see only the bends and wrinkles of living. Gracious God, we yearn to dwell in peace and safety. We want justice and peace to flow like a mighty stream in our world. Let not our fears build walls of separation between us. May we not hesitate to speak when our words could right a wrong. Remind us, O God, that you call us to be peacemakers. Send your spirit to wrap us in courage and dissolve our fears. Pour out your love so that we may be filled with compassion. Let us live in the way of Jesus so that we may enjoy a life of shalom, your peace for all. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. And this is the time of the service that we open up our hearts and our wallets as the ushers come forward to collect our offering.
Thank you.
O God, you are the source of life and the giver of light to all peoples. You provide for our needs and care for us. We bring these gifts in response to your goodness. Use what we offer and use us so that we might do Christ's work of love and be his hands in this hurting world. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you. Please be seated.
Good morning to you on this beautiful summer day. It was lovely driving down from Barnegat to come to worship with you today. So we're very privileged to be here. A few years ago, I read a book called The Ways of God, written by the Blackaby brothers. And there was a quote in there that I keep inside of my Bible that says, every time I read the Word of God, every time I open the Word, I'm standing in the presence of the author. So today, let us hear what the author has said for us to learn. From John 8, verses 31 to 38. Then Jesus said to the Jews who believed in him, if you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. They answered him, we are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free? Jesus answered them, verily, truly, I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are descendants of Abraham, yet you look for an opportunity to kill me because there is no place for you in my word. I declare what I have seen in the Father's presence. As for you, you should do what you have heard from the Father. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. I greet you this morning in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, celebrating the presence of Jesus in our lives this morning. I would ask you this morning if you are glad to be in the house of the Lord. In some places, somebody might even say amen. But I would remind you today that you are the dwelling place of God. You are the temple of the living God. You who believe in him, you who trust him, you who follow him, you are the temple of the living God, not the four walls or the roof. So when I ask the question, are you glad to be in the house of the Lord? There ought to be an innermost resounding response that says, amen. That's me in the house of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
We are glad to be with you this morning. My name is Jim Nags. I'm not often called Reverend Jim Nags, although I'm an ordained minister. I'm more often called the commissioner, and it's a good thing. It's not a bad thing. We're from the Salvation Army, as you can tell by our uniforms. There are S's on our epaulets. The S's represent the words saved to serve, not Salvation Army. The toll taker at the booth coming over the bridge this morning, which actually caught me a little bit by surprise. I had to find change. It's not easy pass. But the toll taker asked me if I was from the Sheraton Hotel. Now, we do get that occasionally. And once in a while, I've stayed in a Sheraton Hotel, whereby I've learned it's just easier to carry the luggage than it is to explain. But I would warn you, the tips aren't very good when that happens. It's a blessing to be here from the Salvation Army. We share a commonality where our faith moves into action. that I'm hearing from this church, from our Gate Community Church, even this morning, in the prayers and in the words being spoken. Salvation Army is a church in action. We are absolutely a denomination of the Protestant side of life, founded in 1865, first called the Christian Mission, soon thereafter to be known as the Salvation Army. But today, the Salvation Army exists in 135 countries around the world, quite dominantly focused and growing particularly strongly in Africa and India, even as we speak. There are 3,600 officers of the Salvation Army in America. That would be ordained ministers. An officer in the Salvation Army is an ordained minister, male and female, which I see you enjoy here as well. Not every church does, but we do here, and that's a good thing. In America, there are 7,600 centers of operation that try to serve God on a daily basis. We offer 4 million meals a week in America. We served 32 million Americans last year. That comes out to about 1 per second on the clock. We have 126 alcohol and drug rehab centers. We offer more than 4 million meals a week, $192 million in rent and utility assistance. Last night in America, 30,000 people stayed in Salvation Army shelters across the country. If you don't know much about us, it's probably a good thing. It means you haven't needed us. I didn't come here to tell you about the Salvation Army today, only to introduce something of the ground on which I stand and to which God has called my wife and me into his service to serve him faithfully. And I celebrate with you your intentions to act in your faith and to be demonstrators of the faith of Christ in your lives. This is a powerful passage, particularly from the Bible that Carolyn just read, particularly on this Independence weekend that we celebrate here in America and that we have sung about even this morning in our hymns. Listen to this unanimous declaration of the 13 colonies back on July the 4th, 1776. I won't read the whole thing, but I give an idea what they thought about freedom, which is what we're speaking of this morning. When in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all people, all men, are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among them these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes. And accordingly, all experience hath shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations, you have to think that through, pursuing invariably the same object, evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient sufferance of these colonies, and such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former systems of government. The history of the, it says present King of Britain, of course it means past, is a history of repeated injuries and usurpations, all having in direct object the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. To prove this, let facts be submitted to a candid world. And so the Declaration of Independence was written about freedom. It was written about the freedom to choose, the freedom to live, the freedom to be ourselves. And then, of course, it's followed by 27 facts as to how the freedoms were affected by the government in those days. I want to suggest to you this morning by the Word of God that freedom comes not so much by a declaration of politicians, but rather from true discipleship with Christ. From John 8, in verses 31 and 32, the Word says, Jesus said to the Jews who had come to believe in him, if you remain in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Few New Testament passages have such a complete picture of discipleship as these two verses. The first thing we learn from this passage is that discipleship begins with belief. It said, so Jesus said to the Jews who had come to believe in him. Its beginning is the moment when a person accepts what Jesus says as true. All that he says about the love of God, all that he says about the terror of sin, all that he says about the real meaning of life. I want to ask you this morning, I know you're here, I know I'm preaching to the converted, but do you believe him? Are you a believer? Do you believe that Jesus went to the cross of Calvary? You know, the song speaks that our sins nailed him there. And I suppose theologically that's accurate. But I would say to you this morning that while our sins may have nailed him there, it was his love that held him there. His love for you and his love for me. And when on the cross he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He wasn't speaking simply of those who had crucified him on the cross that particular day. He was speaking of us. He was speaking of the way that we have been disobedient, the way that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And if you believe that and you receive that, then you would know as well that after he died in three short days, he rose again with the resurrection power and glory for me and for you, that we might be set free. That's the word of God. Discipleship begins with belief. Thomas Watson, not the founder of IBM, but a minister of the 1800s, said this, to serve God, to love God, to enjoy God is the sweetest freedom in the world. Dwight Moody, the famous preacher from Chicago, said, if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are free. I hope that describes you this morning. It certainly describes me. Jesus said to the Jews who had come to believe in him, so discipleship begins with belief, if you remain in my word, you are truly my disciples. So discipleship means also constantly remaining in the word of Jesus. And I would suggest to you this morning, that involves four things. It involves constant listening to the words of Jesus. In the era of America's Declaration of Independence, John Brown of Haddington became one of the most beloved pastors Scotland ever produced. His prolific pen authored over 50 books, tracts, and pamphlets. Including in these writings were major works on church history, a Bible dictionary, all sorts of things. It was said of John Brown of Haddington that when he preached, he paused every now and then, as if listening for a voice. Discipleship means constantly listening to the word of Jesus. Do you hear the word of Jesus? If you're not a believer, you'll find it difficult. If you are, you just have to listen carefully, and he will speak to you even this morning. The Christian is the person who throughout his life listens for the voice of Jesus and will take no decision until they have first heard what he has to say. So discipleship means remaining in the word of Jesus. It involves constant listening. It also involves constant learning from Jesus. The disciple is literally the learner, for that's what the original Greek word means. All of our lives, a Christian should be learning more and more about Jesus. The closed mind is the end of discipleship. Winky Pratney, who is a Kiwi Christian leadership guru, has said this: the Holy Spirit is the gift of the risen Christ. His anointing, filling, empowering work is a baptism of love that gives power to make Jesus real to you and known to others. Being a disciple means listening to the word of Jesus. It means learning from Jesus. It means constant penetrating into the truth which the words of Jesus bear. No one can read the words of Jesus once and then say they understand their full meaning. The difference between a great book and an ephemeral one lies in the fact that we read a book with a short lifespan once and never wish to go back to it, whereas we read a great book many times. To remain in the word of Jesus means to constantly to study and think about what he said until more and more of its meaning becomes ours. I believe that's why you're here this morning, to learn more of the truth of the words that Jesus bear. Harry Emerson Fosdick said, the steady discipline of intimate friendship with Jesus results in people becoming like him. And then it involves constant obeying of the word of Jesus. We study it simply, not simply for academic satisfaction or intellectual appreciation, but in order to find out what God wishes us to do. The disciple is the learner who learns in order to do. The truth which Jesus brought is designed for action, as we've said this morning. The hymn from John Samuel says this: trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. So we understand this morning that discipleship begins with belief. It means remaining in the word of Jesus that has four major components. And then we learn in the same passage that discipleship issues in knowledge of the truth. To learn from Jesus is to learn the truth. You will know the truth, said Jesus. What is the truth? There are many possible answers to that question, but the most comprehensive way to put it is that the truth which Jesus brings shows us the real values of life. The very fundamental question to which every person is consciously or unconsciously to give an answer is, what am I to give my life? To what am I to give my life? To a career? To the amassing of material possessions? To pleasure? To the service of God? In the truth of Jesus, we see what things are really important and what things are not. And then we understand that discipleship results in freedom. So Jesus said to the Jews who came to believe in him, if you remain in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. In his service is perfect freedom. Discipleship brings us four freedoms. Listen to what they are. It brings us freedom from fear. The person who is a disciple never again has to walk alone. They walk forever in the company of Jesus, and in that company, fear is gone. Have you had a few steps in your journey where you felt all by yourself? You weren't alone. If you're a believer, God was with you. God is with you. God could be leading you. Secondly, it brings us freedom from self. It brings us freedom from fear. Then it brings us freedom from self. Many a person fully recognizes his greatest handicap is their own self, and they may in despair cry out, I can't change myself. I've tried, but it's impossible. But the power and presence of Jesus can recreate a person until they're altogether new. So it brings us freedom from fear, from self. It brings us freedom from other people. There are many whose lives are dominated by the fear of what other people may think and say. H.G. Wells once said that the voice of our neighbors sounds louder in our ears than the voice of God. I think many of us have been guilty of that through our lives. The disciple is the person who has ceased to care what people say because they think only of what God says. And then fourthly, it brings freedom from sin. Many a person has come to the stage where they sin not because they want to, but because they can't help it. Their sins have so mastered them that try as they will, they can't break away from them. Discipleship breaks the chains which binds us to them and enables us to be the person we know we ought to be. William Barclay writes, oh, that a person may arise in me, that the person I am may cease to be. That is the very prayer which the disciple of Christ will find answered. Freedom this morning speaks to all these aspects, but they speak clearly to the reality that if we are disciples of Christ, we are free indeed, free from all these other issues in our lives. Sojourner Truth was born a slave in 1797 up along the Hudson River in New York State, and learned from her mother at a very young age about a God who heard her prayers. By the age of 13, she had been sold twice and was alone with no family. But she was also 6 feet tall and strong as any man, with a faith in God and an internal strength that would lead her to the calling God had for her. In 1826, that would have made her 29, though she'd been promised freedom by slave owner John Dumont, and though the law in the state where she lived would require she be freed the following year, Dumont wouldn't let her go. So she packed up her things, finished all her work, picked up her baby, and walked to freedom, leaving a young son behind. She said later, "Truth is powerful, and it prevails." She found safety in the home of a devout Quaker couple who taught her about the laws of the state, read to her from the Bible, and bought her freedom. With their help, she worked with attorneys to become the first black woman to win a court case against white man, Dumont, who had illegally sold her son. In 1843, Isabella, which was her real name, had a vision. God was calling her to travel and teach the truth about Jesus and the freedom he died to give us. She called herself Sojourner Truth and set out on foot with only coins in her pocket to become a powerful orator, abolitionist, and advocate for women's rights. Her towering presence, her singing voice, and her ability to preach stunned audiences and convinced many of sin. Even among abolitionists, she advocated for reliance on God. After hearing a speech by abolitionist Frederick Douglass advocating for slaves to seize freedom, she asked, "Is God gone?" She knew Jesus was the one who made her free. During the Civil War, she encouraged African-American men to fight for the Union. After the war, she helped freed slaves to find jobs and build new lives. Abraham Lincoln knew of her work and welcomed her into the White House. Nell Painter, an American historian notable for her works on United States Southern history, and who was retired from Princeton University as the Edwards Professor of American History, said this: the force that brought her, Sojourner Truth, into the authority of public advocacy was the power of the Holy Spirit. Her ability to call upon a supernatural power gave her a resource that transformed her from Isabella, domestic servant, to Sojourner Truth, a hero for at least three centuries. Loved ones, this morning we're speaking about freedom in Christ. We're speaking about the freedom we can have and we can enjoy and we can experience as disciples of Christ. The final sentence of the Declaration of Independence says this: "And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of the divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor." The sacred honor is more than just an assent to a political ideology. The sacred honor is the belief in Christ. The sacred honor is to follow God, and he will set you free. And he who is free by Christ is free indeed. May God bless you this morning. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires are known, and for whom no secrets are hid, cleanse our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Friends, this is the joyful feast, love feast, of the people of God. The Bible says they'll come from the north and the south and from the east and the west and sit at the table in the kingdom of God. According to Luke, it was when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples. He took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. Our Lord Jesus invites us to this table. He has prepared this feast by sacrificing his own body and blood. All who believe and trust in him are welcome to this feast. Let us pray. Holy God, we praise you. We bless you for creating the whole world, for your promises to your people, and for Jesus Christ in whom your fullness dwells. Born of Mary, he shares our life. Eating with sinners, he welcomes us. Guiding his children, he leads us. Visiting the sick, he heals us. Dying on the cross, he saves us. Risen from the dead, he gives us new life. Living with you, he prays for us. With thanksgiving, we take this bread and this cup and proclaim the death and resurrection of our Lord. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and this meal. Make us one with Christ and with all who share this feast. Unite us in faith, encourage us with hope, inspire us to love, that we may serve as your faithful disciples until we feast at your table in glory. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. The deacons will now pass out the communion element. The Bible tells us that it was on the night that Jesus was arrested that he took bread. And when he gave thanks for it, he broke it and gave thanks to his disciples and said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us eat together and be thankful. After supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks for it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us drink together and be thankful. Apostle Paul reminds us that each time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord. These are God's gifts to us as God's beloved children.
Pastor Vicki asks that I add these following people to our prayer list: David McCain, Ken Heck, Cynthia Mario, Neil Gamble, Bobby Mario's granddaughter Lexi and family, Susan Lothian, sons-in-law James, Carl, Mary Lou Adams, who is gaining strength, Garrow Gazarian, who is recovering at home after a very serious illness, Lynn Daly's stepdaughter Pat, Nancy Schwartz's daughter Beth and grandson Dylan, Steve Jacoby's grandson, Kevin, Carl Ekstrom, Linda Donovan's mother, Gladys, Ginny Beck's friend, Kathy, Jean Ponteri, who was at Villa Raffaello in Pleasantville, and also Dana. Are there any other joys or concerns to share? Yes. Oh, congratulations. How nice. Let us pray together, please. Merciful God, we have gathered together this morning as brothers and sisters in Christ, made in your image, and each of us all called by name, by you, to proclaim the good news of your love. We thank you for the gifts we have received at your table this morning. We thank you for the promises that you have made and kept through your Son, Jesus. Let your love be made known through us. As you demonstrated for us so clearly, help us to live in the spirit of love, in the spirit of forgiveness, and the spirit of humble service. Dear Lord, we ask again for peace for our planet. We pray, Lord, that you will calm the violence that is so prevalent in our world. We lift up our country before you, praying for peace among the nations and a restoration of righteousness and integrity within our land. Loving God, we are thankful that we can bring to you the needs of our family members, congregation, and friends. We hold up to you those we have already mentioned and those only known to us in our hearts. May your comfort come to those whose sorrow wiping away their tears. May your peace fill the lives of those torn apart by conflicts within their relationships. May your wisdom guide those who need to choose carefully the way they should go. May your healing hand be upon those who are sick and blanket those in pain. Above all, may your love find its way into our hearts, that our spirits may soar in the confidence that whatever takes place, you will always be with us. We pray all these things in the strong name of Jesus, who long ago taught those he loved to pray by saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Please turn to page 698 in your bulletin. There's a misprint this morning, and the hymn is God of the Ages, and we're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and give thee peace. Amen. God bless you this morning.